Greetings, everyone. I'm Joe Lucia, University Librarian here at Villanova, and I want to welcome you all to this year, 2012, One Book Villanova Author Talk. We have, a really great event here this evening, and I'd venture to say, I could be wrong, and Jamie can correct me, that this may be the first time it's been welcomed to a lecture by a public drum exhibition. I hope so. I hope that Villanova goes down in the record books in his career for having done that for him. I want to thank the drummers again. They did a great job. Take a page from my good friend and colleague Terry Nance. She calls our opening the call to community. And the drums certainly serve that role for us again this year. I want to say a few words before turning the mic over to our speaker about all the people who make this event possible from year to year, because it truly is a community effort that extends before and then beyond this evening. And there are a host of individuals that are involved from large-scale planning to the smallest details, including, for instance, for many of you who this evening experienced the incredible dinner, which has become a part of our annual event. And if you haven't, come next year to the dinner, because it's always a wonderful prelude to this talk, and it is open to the public for a very modest fee. So I want to thank, first of all, my committee co-chairs, Dr. Terry Nance, Associate Vice President for Multicultural Affairs, and Mr. Tom Mogan, the Director of Student Development, who work together with me every year to select a book and then prepare a series of programs around it. And it's a true honor and pleasure to work with them on behalf of all of you. So thank you, Terry and Tom. Terry will be up here at the podium briefly later to introduce our student panelists. I also want to thank some of the supporting cast, in particular, Joan Prendergast from the Center for Multicultural Affairs, who is part of the glue that holds this event together for us every year. In addition to Joan, some members of my staff, in particular, Janine Ahern and on my office staff, and also Jeff Eisenberg, who is a grad student assistant in the library from the Department of Communication, who's done remarkable work in helping this all happen. So thanks to both of you. I also want to thank Kathleen Scavello from University Communications, who's been really tireless in helping promote this event with the public at large, and even this year managed to arrange a radio interview for our author before his appearance at Villanova. So thank you, Kathleen, for that. And again, I can't name all the people on the rather gargantuan One Book Committee, so I will just say thanks to all of you for everything you do to make this possible every year. It involves reading a lot of books, arguing about a lot of books, and trying to find the right one. So I will just say this now before bring this year's book we are thrilled to have as our 2012 selection. And I'm willing to say that it's a quiet, tender story of love that also looks at a difficult period in American history, and it has become an international phenomenon. In 2 years, already translated into 32 languages, I learned today, which is quite amazing. I've had the great pleasure of spending some time with Jamie Ford today, and have discovered him to be a wonderfully witty, entertaining observer of culture and the world around him, in addition to being a gifted writer. And I think you're in for a treat listening to him tonight. He's going to talk to you for a while, and then we're going to invite a small group of student panelists to come up here and have a conversation with him. So without further ado then, Jamie.
Wow, okay. First thing I want to do is make a brief comment on social media by taking your photo. So I'll just... You'll just indulge me. I'm going to take two, so. Everyone smile and say, Facebook. All right. And you can smile and say, Twitter. Okay. All right. Thank you. That way my publicist also knows I actually showed up, so that's good. That's good. This is a sight to behold. This is so not my normal authorly event. As a debut novelist, my normal authorly event, my normal book gig, is that quintessential... Is that a little better?
Yeah.
There we go. Okay. I have a lapel mic. Is that on?
No, but that's only for the camera.
Oh, it's only for the camera. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. In that case, can you hear me in the back?
Yeah.
Yay. Okay. Are you ready for my karaoke? Okay. Yeah. No. You don't want to go there. This really isn't my normal bookstore event. You know, really, as a debut novelist, my normal book gig is, you know, I'm at an independent bookstore on some random Tuesday night, about 7 p.m., going head-to-head with Dancing with the Stars. And you can't win that battle. And I say that half in jest, but I did do an event about a year ago, and I did it in Washington, D.C. at Politics and Prose, this stalwart independent bookstore. And, you know, I roll into town, and I have a cousin that lives in town, and so I emailed him. You know, he's in the D.C. area, and I'm emailing him like, you know, please come out to the bookstore, you know, support the family. And he emails me back and says, I'd really love to be there, but tonight Tom DeLay is dancing the cha-cha. It's my humbling moment from the road, of which there have been many. I want to ask, because I'm always curious, and this question pertains to interviews. And I do, as a debut novelist, I've been very fortunate to do, you know, a fair number of interviews, you know, television and print, but I do a ton of radio interviews, and I do them primarily on my cell phone, because that's how you do them now. And so it's interesting, I can do an interview in Madison, Wisconsin, and I'll be live on the air in Lexington, Kentucky. But what's really curious is those interviews are recorded live to tape, and then they get disseminated to other affiliates. And so I'll get emails that say, I really love that interview you did in Topeka. And I'm thinking, I've never been to Topeka. It must have been one of those interviews. But I did one not that long ago, and I was in Portland, Oregon, and I was in my hotel room. I was on my trusty cell phone, and it was live. And there was this tremendous moment of live radio that went just like this. Housekeeping! And it's happened twice now, and I had the thing hanging on my door, which I've learned is strictly advisory. There's no enforcement of that device. But if you happen to be listening to NPR and you hear this interview where this woman brings me fresh towels, please email me and let me know how that sounds, because I'm dying to hear that one. Interviews. And we're going to have a student panel, and we're going to do Q&A, and we're going to talk about aspects of the book and aspects of storytelling and whatever else, you know, wherever the conversation leads us. But in those interview settings, I get asked certain questions, and we were talking about this at lunch. I get the hotel on the corner of Bitter and Sweet, it deals with the Japanese internment, so I get asked about that naturally. There are aspects of the jazz scene as it existed in Seattle at the time, and I'm happy to talk about anything. And it's also a family story, a father and son story. And again, we'll discuss. But the one aspect that I never get asked about in an interview setting is the love story, and I find that interesting. And it's probably because love stories are these peculiar creatures. You know, we with love stories, you either get them or you don't. And I love that this is a collegiate setting. And as soon as I said love stories, I can look into the audience, and I can see that the young women are like, love stories? And the guys are like, oh no, he's not going there, is he? You know, I think I have calculus to do. But it is, and because I never get asked about the love story, I do want to take a few minutes and talk about that, which is sort of the story inside the story. And, you know, love stories really you know, we react to them differently. We take our own emotional baggage, we bring it to the party, and we react. And you can see that. If this was a movie theater and it was playing, you know, a love story tearjerker kind of movie, when the lights come on, you can really look in the audience and you can see reactions, and you can see that almost the two camps emerge. You have that one camp that's, you know, they're fishing in their purse for Kleenex. And then you see that other group that's looking around bewildered, like, that was a waste of $9, you know. Where was the car crash? Where was the gun battle? Where was the asteroid collision? I paid for an asteroid collision. I want an asteroid collision. But I knew, not just as an author, but as a human being, where I fell on that emotional Richter scale from a very painfully young age. And I was about 9 years old. And at the time, I was living in this great little town of Ashland, Oregon. It's this lovely theater town. But if you happen to be growing up in Southern Oregon in the late 60s, early 70s, we were blessed or cursed, depending on how you look at it, to only have one television channel. And so as a result of that, you just watch whatever's on. And so I watched some weird television. And I watched this movie as a child that really informed the kind of storyteller I turned out to be. It's a story that kind of haunted me to this day. And it was this movie of the week, your typical ABC movie of the week kind of thing. And it was this movie called James at 15. Does anyone remember this movie? Wow. Do not be alarmed. My people are here. I just love that. James at 15 was a very simple love story. And it was about this young boy pining away for this impossible girl. And he gets the girl in this very benign 70s kind of way. It's very innocent. But James at 15 didn't end on that note. James at 15 ends on this scene where he and his family are packing up and moving to Boston. And so those poor tortured souls that remember this movie, James at 15 ends with the U-Haul packed, and James is in the back of the all-American wood panel station wagon that we all used to drive, and he's staring out the window to his sweetheart, who's on the corner staring back, and he's just waving goodbye, and they just pull on down the road. And there was this sad piano music, and the credits just started to roll, and that was the end. And I remember watching that ending as a little kid and just thinking, oh, love sucks. This is awful. And it was so horrible. It was the first time as a little kid that I'd ever seen a complicated interpersonal relationship that didn't come from Disney. And there's nothing wrong with Disney, you know, but The Nutty Professor was about as deep as I went. And I was so caught up in the story, I was so vested in these characters that when it didn't end the way I had anticipated, you know, I was stricken. I mean, I was choked up. I was moved to tears, real tears. And it wasn't even the dismissive, you know, it's my allergies, you know, kind of a moment. I'm just like sobbing at this terrible, sad ending. And, you know, in retrospect, my father's sitting next to me in his easy chair. And I'm a dad. There's plenty of gentlemen here. I know there's plenty of dads in the room. Every dad has what I call the dad list. Every dad has some form of the dad list. We all do. And I can picture my dad regarding his young son just bawling at this cheesy movie of the week and taking out his imaginary dad list and just thinking, football scholarship, no. Basketball, no. And as a result, not just of that night, but probably a lot of nights like that, my dad actually encouraged me to go into the arts. So, you know, I always say I scored a writer's touchdown, Dad. You know, someone has to, right? And that was, the thing is, I go to school the next day, and everyone at school is calling me James at 15. My given name is James, and they're like, hey, James at 15, James at 15. because they all saw the same movie, right? We all had one channel. But they all hated it. I loved that movie. And in a textbook moment of peer pressure collapse, I just clammed up about that experience. I took that moment, I packed it up, I tucked it into the attic of my mind, never to look at again, until I was fumbling around with this thing called fiction. And when you're a writer, it's difficult figuring out what to write about, and in what manner to go about it, and what voice to write in. And it's like when you're a writer, whether you're a writer of fiction or nonfiction or prose or poetry or song lyrics or screenplays, it's like being given a box of a million crayons, and you have to choose your colors. And at the time, I was trying out a lot of different things. You know, I'm half Chinese on my dad's side, and I had never written anything with Asian American characters because I just didn't think anybody cared. And so I didn't go there. And I love history, but I always thought history was the realm of nonfiction, so I didn't go there. And as you'll come to realize, I do have a deep abiding weakness for love stories, but I didn't go there. But where I did go about that time with my then fiancé, now wife, is we went to one of these weekends for newly engaged couples, which that alone is kind of this weird social experiment. seemed like a good idea at the time. But we went, and you know, we walked in, and it was apparent, because we were so much older than everyone else in the room, that we were like the chaperones on prom night. You know, we walked in, and people think we're the host couple asking us where to go, and we're like, you know, I know you're young, but you don't have a monopoly on love. We're in love too. And what they had us do at this weekend was they had us stand up and tell the Cliff's Notes version of how we first met. And it goes around the room, and the first couple, the sterling young gentleman, stands up, and he turns to his beloved and says, and I quote, "Well, I woke up and she had my t-shirt on. I figured I better ask her what her name was." Yeah, I think my wife fainted, you know, the heavens parted, and it was so romantic. And it goes around the room, and everyone's still in college, or they're just out of college, and so everyone's first date was like a frat party, or it was spring break, or somehow jello shooters were involved. And it comes around to me, and I had to stand up in front of this group. I had to stand up in this post-collegiate coupling experiment and confess to them that I met my wife at that hotbed of swinging singles activity known as the public library. That was their reaction. It was this patina of nervous laughter, like, ha ha, no, where'd you meet her? It was the library. It wasn't singles night at the library. It wasn't wet t-shirt night at the library. It was, I wasn't hanging out in the 300 section hitting on strange women that cruise by. And for those of you that don't remember your Dewey Decimal System, that's human sexuality. It was just the public library. But see, that's when I knew I wasn't James at 15. I was James at 40. And I was this weird, precocious kid, and I became this weird, precocious adult, and I took a lot of things that I perceived as weaknesses, and I tried to turn them into strengths, and I really wrote what I wanted to write, which was kind of a noble romantic tragedy, something multicultural, something that dealt with history. But beyond that, and I guess this is the other part of the equation that I should confess. In addition to meeting my wife at the library, a year later, I actually proposed in a bookstore. and that's when I knew it was, I was going to be James at something for the rest of my life. And with that, I'd love to have our students up, and we'll continue this conversation.
This is not the end. This is only the beginning. Wasn't that wonderful? My husband right now is going, oh my God, don't let her start talking. It is my pleasure to really kick off this next part of the program, and we are really excited about this. As you know, the One Book Villanova program is really about how to bring the community together. And obviously, probably the most numerous, the section of our community that is probably the largest would be the students. And so we thought, what better than to have the student voices coming to the author and asking some direct questions. So, representing the students tonight, I would like to first call to the podium Stephanie Ubal. Stephanie hails from Marlton, New Jersey. She's a freshman, and she has the best major, undecided. Undecided in the College of Arts and Sciences. So that's a wonderful major. And at Villanova, even in just a short period of time, she's a member of Villanova Voices, the Dance Ensemble, and the Leadership Learning Community. And her favorite book is Beloved by Toni Morrison. Next, I'd like to go to the other end of the scale and call our senior to the podium, and that would be Christopher Horn, hailing from Randolph, Massachusetts. And he has that other major that I love to talk about, communication. And he is also with a peace and justice concentration. Chris is a highly involved student, as so many of you are, but in particular, I'd like to call out, he was 3 years on the orientation staff and is the current vice president of a wonderful organization that, if you haven't heard about, I hope that you will ask him about later. He is the vice president of the Invisible Children's Organization. And when I think of Chris and think of his most noteworthy accomplishments, I just saw him recently at the Villanova Who's Who dinner, and then he said that his other most noteworthy accomplishment is when he dressed as Santa and did a flash dance in the library during finals week. So I thought that was pretty good. His favorite book, coming right from the headline, would be The Girl Who Played with Fire by Stieg Larsson. Finally, I'd like to call Sam Ellison, who is from Dresher, Pennsylvania, to the stage. Sam is a sophomore communication major who is interested in becoming a journalist, so maybe he will be one of those radio interviewers in the future. He writes for the Villanovan, and he was also a part of the winning team, the Championship of America Distance Medley Relays at the Penn Relays this past spring, and he was a freshman. When I asked Sam, you know, like, what's something unusual you want to talk about? And he said, well, I'm tall, but don't ask me any more about it. So we're not going to ask him any more about it. And interestingly, Sam's favorite book is A Thousand Splendid Suns by the first One Book Villanova author, Khalid Husseini. And so with that, I am going to turn the microphone over to Stephanie, who will be asking our first question. And by the way, I hope that you are starting to get your own questions ready, and that we have paper for them, paper, and you can write them down and pass them down the aisle, and we will have one book Villanova volunteers will be picking up your questions. So let's get started, Steph.
First, we'd just like to start by thanking Jamie for being here with us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
It's wonderful to have you here. So for the first question, as a first-time author, what was your reaction to the news that your book had been chosen for One Book Villanova?
I always have the same astounded reaction. You know, my bar for success was so low. My bar for success was to have someone read the book that didn't share my same last name. Once I cleared that, it's all just been magical. I was really excited. I mean, honestly, this is a very prestigious university. But community reads campus reads, high school reads, even a few corporate reads. I'm in, later in the spring, I'm doing a prison read. Anytime a community comes together collectively to read something and have a discussion about it, I think that's incredibly healthy. And if I can be part of that, if I can, you know, vicariously be, you know, this token catalyst, it's amazing to behold. It really feels like the book takes on a life of its own, and I'm just watching in amazement as these opportunities present themselves.
Well, we definitely think that you delivered a writer's touchdown.
Thanks.
But just going back to the beginning, what inspired you to write Hotel on the Corner of Bitter and Sweet?
Sure. The book started as a short story, and it was a 30-page short story I wrote at a workshop in Virginia in 2006. And I'd been researching the time period for another story. My Chinese grandparents met at a backroom gambling parlor in Seattle. And I was researching that venue, and I had a lot of the lay of the land and kind of the grit of that time period under my fingernails. I go to this conference, and they had us write, like, you know, go, produce magic now. And I had this landscape already rendered in my imagination. I just needed to animate some characters. And an element that I had been thinking about was the I Am Chinese button. It was something that my father wore, and his cousins wore, and a lot of Chinese Americans wore. My father wore one of those buttons right after the bombing of Pearl Harbor. My Chinese American father, because he would walk to school and kids would throw rocks at him, calling him a Jap. And it was this iconic totem, this thing that I wrote this story about, and I created the characters Henry and Keiko, and it started from there. And an editor encouraged me to write it as a novel, and a couple years later, here I am.
So going off of that, which character was the most difficult for you to write in your process?
Most difficult to write, probably Henry's father. I think it's, I have to consciously make people bad. You know, you have to generate someone that is an antagonist. And I'm not so sold on people that are just Hollywood black hat. You know, most of the bad guys in history thought they were doing a just thing, you know, aside from a few crazy psychopaths. And even in their mind, their dog was telling them it was the just thing. But, you know, to create a character that that was so problematic for Henry, but also someone that he still had to love, or at least obey, or respect, or follow, or live with, it dredged up a lot of emotional baggage from my own childhood. And that was probably, once I realized where I was going and that it was going to be kind of a cathartic process, I just shamelessly went with it. But it was hard to go there initially.
So how much of yourself did you put into this novel? You just kind of mentioned your emotional baggage from your childhood. So, you know, were there any characters who, you know, were you, in a sense?
I'm Mrs. Beatty. I'm a Chinese guy in a Caucasian lunch lady's body. It's not autobiographical, it's not biographical, but there's a lot of familial angst in there from my life, from my dad's life, and some from my grandfather's life. And I think a lot of authors do that. The more authors I know, the more familiar I am with their work, the more I see types and shadows of their life, bits and, you know, they would deny it, but it's there. And I see that sometimes. You know, they say, you know, writers prick their fingers and bleed on the page. Hotel is definitely a heart transplant for me. There's a lot there. You know, I'm not Henry. Henry is the noble person I wish I was. You know, it's, you know, the characters of Sheldon. They're probably characters that I I wish I was capable of those kind of sacrifices in those moments, but I doubt that I, you know, I create this character that I look up to, rather than, you know, into the mirror.
And throughout the novel, it seems that Henry's understanding of the symbol of the I am Chinese button seems to change. Does that in any way reflect on your own sense of identity?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When you're half something, it's very complicated. And that's not to say, like, if you're half English, half Welsh, you know, that's not so complicated. But you know what I mean. It's hard because I remember filling out college applications and apartment applications, and, you know, there'll be a box where you're supposed to check your ethnicity, and there's Asian or white. There's never half. And I was always confused. And it's even more confounding when you're growing up, because as a teenager, you're struggling to find a self-identity anyway. But my dad spoke fluent Chinese. I was that generation that a lot of us didn't speak it. And so I would go to family gatherings, which were frequent, and I was one of the handful of a few that didn't speak Chinese. So I never felt Chinese enough. And then when my Caucasian friends come over to the house and we're eating chicken wing or chicken feet or, you know, jellyfish or, you know, something that's not normal for, you know, middle America, then I didn't feel white enough. You know, I knew I was different. And it's hard. You know, at some point, you know, Barack Obama, you know, you identify one with the other, and sometimes it's your circumstance, your environment, how people perceive you, and sometimes it's just how you want to be perceived. It was interesting that when I had several editors interested in the book, and one of them wanted me to write under a Chinese name. My grandfather's Chinese name was Chung, and my grandmother's maiden name was, or great-grandmother's maiden name was Chu, and wanted me to, you know, thought that would be helpful. And I just thought, you know, Ford's confusing, and that's okay. It makes for an interesting story, and I'll just be who I am. And so I found as I wrote, and by the time the book was published, I had sort of figured out who I was.
Going off of that, you talk about your own identity. What struggles did your parents and your ancestors have transitioning into American culture?
My great-grandfather came over around 1860. He was named Min Chong, and he changed his name to William Ford around 1890. Early identity theft or something like that. I always describe it as someone coming to this country now and changing their name to Chuck Norris. You know, it's a red-blooded American name. But, you know, part of the reason I think he took that name was, at the time, he was not allowed to buy property in Nevada. And I think he was part owner of a hotel later in his life, and I think that was, he was capable of doing that because on the documents, nobody knew he was Chinese. Things like that, you know, we didn't have, Washington was one of the few states around the turn of the last century that didn't have, you know, miscegenation laws in the books forbidding a Chinese, you know, woman from marrying a Caucasian man and vice versa. And so growing up in the Seattle area, it was, you know, it wasn't Birmingham, Alabama, but there were still zoning laws that stipulated that if you weren't Caucasian, you could only buy property in certain neighborhoods. And this is in the 40s and the 50s. And so you had Chinatowns and Japantowns, and you had these neighborhoods with, you know, Korean people and Black people and Filipino people living there culturally, but also society was marginalizing them in that direction. And those things happened. I remember my grandfather telling me that the only jobs available to him when he was my age, and this was when I was in college, was laundry, restaurant, taxi driver, or backroom gambling. He chose backroom gambling. So I think he has like a master's degree in, you know, blackjack or something. It's kind of the Chinese education. But, and of course that's changed. And but not so much that, you know, it's such a point of pride in my family if someone, they don't say it, they're like, you know, he's a senior vice president at Boeing, and he's Chinese. You know, that generation still tags that on, you know, even if they don't say it, it comes out in the inflection that they're so proud and that those times have changed.
And you mentioned like the zoning laws that are meant to keep certain ethnicities apart, and I was actually just in
that. Would also apply to Jewish Americans and Italian Americans.
Mm-hmm. Right, and all the way up past the 40s into even, you know, like 60s and 70s that existed. And now that transitioned us really well into certain similarities that we still have today.
So a lot of our classmates we were talking about, they've never heard of the internment of Japanese Americans, but it was one of the largest instances of discrimination against an ethnic group in America's history. So in what ways do you think that we practice internment today?
In what ways do we practice internment? That's a good question. Let me ask this question. I'll kind of come back to it and work it in. Who invented the cotton gin? I can go to anywhere in America and I can ask that question and everyone will say Eli Whitney. And if we forget who invented the cotton gin, I don't think we're diminished as a people. But if we forget, if the history books omit that we incarcerated 120,000 people, most of whom were American-born citizens, we are diminished as a people. And we may not incarcerate people wholesale, but it's not because there aren't people that want to. It's because it's not logistically easy. After Pearl Harbor, the FBI contacted banks and got lists of Japanese customers. They had census records. They were living in neighborhoods. It was you could look at someone and say, okay, you're different and you need to come with me. It's harder with Muslim Americans. You know, it's harder with an ideology or a religious belief or something that's held very personal than an exterior appearance. But if it was easier, I think there are people that would feel more comfortable if those people, maybe not were interned, but all had to register and carry a card like Italian Americans did, 600,000 of them during World War II. Something like that. And even if it's not internment, you know, there's such a bias to education funding, to prison populations, to, that's a whole other can of worms. But you know where I'm going. There are marginalized peoples in this country now. And just because they might be sins of omission rather than sins of commission doesn't mean they're not sins. And it's that's how I see it anyway.
Absolutely, and I think one of the reasons that it's harder to see today is, like you mentioned, it's not so overt. You know, we haven't rounded up people physically in a different location. But something that helped me to realize is that parts of the novel that might have seemed extreme to readers are actually true. For instance, the man who was shot in the Japanese internment camp. Can you tell us what other historical facts you base the novel off of in terms of what was happening in America that you discovered?
Right. I try not to editorialize. I try not to take a position and then sensationalize history. I sensationalize the love story. And there were moments as I was doing my research where I stopped. And I grew up in the Seattle area, so I had an institutional memory of the internment, but I kept stumbling into things that I never knew growing up there. I've been to the Puyallup Fairgrounds every summer since I was a kid, and you eat scones, and you ride the roller coasters, and you listen to the Beach Boys or whoever's there. I never knew that that was a temporary, internment camp, that it was once called Camp Harmony. I was reading journal entries of people talking about burning their belongings, their photos, their family photo albums, of burying them in the backyard. Those are things that, you know, it stopped me. And the incident that you mentioned, which was true, was that there was a gentleman who was standing at the wrong place at the wrong time, a Japanese-American gentleman, as some army trucks were coming into camp, and one of the soldiers shot him and killed him. And the soldier was court-martialed, and he was punished. And his punishment was that he was fined the cost of the bullet. And it's a true story. And it was interesting to put that in there. And then that gentleman's niece wrote to me and said, thank you for putting my uncle's story in there. Those moments, you know, it personalizes it. You know, I think fiction is a wonderful canvas to explore history or social events. Nonfiction almost has an emotional distance to it, depending on how it's constructed. But in a novel, you can feel those characters. It's kind of tricky how it works, but it can kind of suck you into that narrative. And it sucked me in as a researcher. And so there were aspects like that that I didn't realize that there were that many people. I had been through Minidoka, Idaho, Jerome, Idaho, and it's flat, kind of ugly, but it's green. Back then it was not irrigated, it was dry scrub, and there were 10,000 people living there. It's just, it was remarkable to me.
Yeah, unfortunately I was also one of those high school students who hadn't heard of the Japanese internment until I got here to college, and I was just fascinated by the fact that it was sort of, you know, propaganda that it was okay for the Japanese people to be living in these harsh conditions. So my question for you is, do you think that the Japanese people could have done more to protest the effects, or do you think it was more an act of heroism, you know, going with the grain and moving into the internment camps just to be patriotic?
Yeah, that's a tough question. These were American citizens, 70-something thousand of them were, and part of it is probably cultural, part of it is being maybe first or second generation living in a foreign country, and that country is at war with your country of ancestry, and so you want to go, I don't mean want to go, but you willingly go because you're afraid you're going to be repatriated to a country you weren't born in, you know, which could be quite, you know, and in Japan they would just regard you as an American. And so I think, I don't know if they went to camp, and I'm generalizing, and I've interviewed countless people, and I don't want to speak for 120,000 people, but there were people that resisted. There were people that went willingly, and then there were people that resisted, and they went unwillingly. And instead of going to Minidoka or Manzanar, they went to Tule Lake, where part of Tule Lake was more like a federal prison. And instead of getting out in 44 or 45, they were kept till 47, kept longer. And it was fought in the courts. And they lost. They won later, but at the time, it wasn't something that, whatever legality was involved was sort of pushed to the side. And later revisited.
So kind of speaking about the Japanese community, Japanese communities today, how have they received your book, and how is that different from how the Chinese communities have received your book?
Japanese American communities really have really received the book well. I've spoken at the Japanese American, you know, National Museum in LA. I've spoken at the Smithsonian, the oldest Japanese language school in the country. I was invited to the Minidoka reunion, and I went. It was a great honor to go and just participate. And it was amazing. It was educational. It was emotional. It was fun. And they had a karaoke night where all these octogenarians were singing "Don't Fence Me In." I was psyched to behold. really cool. And so I think I get a lot of correspondence from Japanese Americans, whether they're, you know, the third Sansei, third generation, or some that the Nisei that are much older now, but really have such a personal, firsthand experience. And I've given talks with former internees, and it's been a real, it's been appreciated in those families, because there was a generation that didn't talk about it very much, if at all. At least not until the redress in the late 80s, and then that they would talk about it, and that next generation was asking about it, but the book provides a nice point of dialogue for some of those families that otherwise that was kind of a closed door. As far as Chinese American communities, there's just, the most of the feedback I get is from the Seattle area, where people that live there, grew up there. It's a neighborhood that, you know, Chinatowns, you know, they get gentrified, and places that mean something emotionally to so many people get paved over and turned into a Starbucks, and they try to hold on to that. You know, that physical presence is part of that culture. And I really wrote the book as a love song to the neighborhood, and there are a lot of people, especially Chinese from that area, that love that I did that and appreciate it.
And we had spoken about this a little bit earlier, but one of the great ways of, you know, immortalizing a story is to put it on the big screen, and I didn't remember from the movies from when you were so young. So have you ever considered adapting this to be produced as a movie?
Well, it's out as a video game right now. So you can download the app. Henry's running from the bullies. The movie thing. I'll make everyone really excited and really sad in the same heartbeat, in that I have a great film agent. I have the same film agent as the estate of Stieg Larsson, as Stephanie Meyer for all the Twilight movies, and she's probably the premier agent for books to film in Hollywood. And she told me, I can guarantee you that your book will be optioned, and I can guarantee you that it will never be made. I know, I was like, yay, thanks. Thanks a lot. And the reason is, I went to Hollywood and Beverly Hills last summer, and with both my film agent and my literary agent, we had a bunch of meetings with really excited producers. The question that kept coming up time and time again was, how do we mitigate the financial risk without a white male lead? I know, right? They're like, Henry, Justin Bieber, what do you think? You know? I think I'm gonna throw up on my shoes. That's the thing. And that's where they wanna go with it. And so I've had lots of offers on the option from small companies with the best of intentions and big companies with the worst of intentions. And so it's like finding an adoptive family for your child. It's because once you give it away, you have no control. And so you can make it a musical, you just can't make Henry white. That's my only thing. And so that's where it's at. We have a couple more offers that we're looking at. You can get it optioned in a heartbeat. Will it get produced? It's a long shot. I mean, really. I mean, everyone wants the next Slumdog Millionaire. They're just not willing to make that leap of faith.
I think this is a good transition into topic of forgiveness in your book, because I noticed it in really a myriad of aspects of your novel. So my question for you is, what is your definition of forgiveness, and how did you apply it to the various situations where it was relevant?
Wow, my definition of forgiveness. has anyone read, like, the Love Languages books? five love languages. There's a book called the five languages of apology, written by the same author. I use that with my teenagers because they'll do something, you know, they'll punch their brother and it's like, say sorry. And they're like, sorry! And you know, it's not a real apology and it's hard to forgive when that happens. And so there's like a love language of apology, of saying you're sorry, saying you're not going to do it again, asking how you can make it better. I mean, there's kind of steps. And when you do that, I think it's easier to forgive. But real forgiveness, I think, beyond that, comes in forgiving someone that isn't capable of apologizing, and someone that's incapable of changing, someone that is incapable of, or they've died, or, you know, the circumstances are such that they're never going to change. They've hurt you, they've offended you, whatever happens. And I think that, you know, that comes, you have to, not, you know, not to turn it into a Dr. Phil moment, but it really has to come from a place of love, where you have to love someone as a person despite how many times life has kicked them around, or how their parents have raised them, or how society has shaped them. You have to give them the benefit of the doubt that they weren't always like that. And for me, I think forgiveness comes from that. And if you can do that, then you can forgive a lot of things. You know, there's, and sometimes, I mean, it helps if there is an effort on the other side. But if you don't, you carry around such baggage. And I know there's no drama like family drama. And every family, there's no perfect family. Everyone's got the drama to some degree. And people that, you know, I see, I have relatives, you know, like two great uncles that, you know, they haven't talked in 30 years and no one can remember what they initially thought about, you know, just like give it up. At some point you gotta give it up to a higher power, give it up to the universe, give it up to yourself, go punch your pillow, cry about it, take a pill about it. But if you carry it around, it's hurting you more than others.
I know, Jamie, you've described yourself as a storyteller, and it certainly sounds like you have a lot of themes of forgiveness and love stories and father and son stories. And I'm sure there's even more than you could have possibly fit into one book. So looking forward, what's next?
Is this the question about the next book?
Yep.
I'm sorry, we're all out of time. Thanks, you've been great. So close. I have a new book that I'm finishing. Should turn it in the next couple months here. Hopefully it'll be out next year. The gestational period for a book is like a year to 18 months. So once I turn it in, it goes into the machine of the publishing world and they print catalogs and galleys and all that stuff. But I do have a new book in the works. And what was your next question? I'm sorry. The story is, because I stay really busy and I'm writing all the time, and it frustrates me that I don't have another book to share with you. And I will get emails from people and they'll say things like, I'm 88 years old, I love your book, and I ain't gonna be around forever, you know. No pressure there. I'm in my iron lung. All I want is your book, your next book, and then I can be my reward. But I have another contract with Random House, same editor, same publisher, and I wrote a second book. My editor loved it, she accepted it. But as Hotel began to do its thing, I became a prisoner of that. And if no one cared who I was, I think my second book would just go. But because Hotel did really well, and they really wanna market did like crazy, and suddenly there's a lot of people in that equation. And it's terrible to say this, but my editor accepted the book, but someone else wanted some changes. And I'm like, okay, well, let me consider those changes. I made those changes, and someone else wanted changes. And I like, okay, well, I want to change that, but now that I've been thinking about it, I'm going to change this to, well, I, since I haven't another 6 months, I did that, really happy with it. They wanted more changes, and I said no. And so I said, you know, what I said to my editor was, it's fine if you want to, I'll make those changes, but my name's going at the bottom, and those three people are gonna, their names are going to go up there with me. Because it's not the same, yeah. But at the same time, when I would turn the manuscript in, I'd have 2 months until they read it and tear it apart and get back to me. So I'd started working on something else. And when I said no, I said, but what about this? And they loved it. And fortunately, I loved it too. And I liked that second book, which at some point I'll probably sell to a different publisher down the road. So I'm working on this other book. So I've been very busy, but I just don't have anything to show for it. But the new book is set in Seattle, very Chinese book, between the years of 1921 and 1931, about a Chinese-American actress and a son that she abandoned. And that's all I'm going to say.
Stephanie, why don't you take the last question?
All right. So what is the most important message that you want Villanova students to take from this book?
Oh, just one. It's like taking one thing to the deserted island. I'm gonna leave you with lots of messages. And maybe this goes out to the students in the room, but also faculty, also just readers who showed up. There's always people that want to write. If I can do it, anyone can do it. You know, I tell people, if you can write, write. If you can't, do what I do. And that's, tell the story you want to tell. Enjoy the process. Allow yourself to grow. And writing is like playing a musical instrument. There's so many of us, you know, you wouldn't sit down at the piano and try to play Rachmaninoff, and when you can't, stand up and go, guess I'm just not a musician. You work at it, you start at it, but so many of us, when we want to write that book, whether it's a memoir, it's a family story, whatever it is, we sit down and we try to play Mozart. And when we can't do it, right out of the gate, we go, I'm just not a writer. It's not how it works. You know, I had lots of practice runs. And if you enjoy the practice, if you enjoy the process, and you see yourself growing, do it. Everyone has a story to tell. Everyone has a family story to tell. Even if you're just writing it for your children and grandchildren, you should write those stories. It doesn't have to be a bestseller. It doesn't have to be published. You can print it up at Kinko's and give it to your family for Christmas. But I think that kind of satisfaction is worth exploring, and that's what I would leave.
Thank you. Well, Jamie, you're not finished yet. Tom has some questions from the audience.
Yeah.
The students actually did a great job in covering many of the questions that were asked in the audience. Questions from probably book club readers that I heard you say earlier on were two of the most popular questions that you get, that you receive from book clubs. The first one is, did Ethel know what was happening to Henry's letters? Did she read the one about meeting at the hotel?
This is the number one book club question. There's probably like drunken fist fights at book clubs over this, wanting to know, arguing over, was Ethel complicit? I hate to say this, but I don't know. But it's not like I wrote an extra chapter and I'm going to release the director's cut for double the price. I just didn't explore Ethel's point of view, so I don't really know. In my heart of hearts, I think she was an unwitting accomplice, but she'd be dead now, so she took that to the grave.
Okay. And what was the purpose of incorporating Chaz into the book?
Oh, you know, Chaz is kind of a shadow antagonist. I wanted a character that seemed like the antagonist, but really the antagonist to Henry's protagonist is his own father. And that's really the bad guy in the story. I kind of wanted this red herring character that was kind of a caricature, but he's really not the bad guy. The bad guy is, you know, there's no strife like, you know, contention within your own home. You know, you can run away from bullies on the street, but when you can't run away from your family, then things are really bad.
Someone asked a question about, has anyone returned to the Panama Hotel to reclaim their family's belongings?
What I've been told by the owner of the hotel is that there were 37 families who stored their belongings, and three families came back after they got out of camp. The rest remain there today. They're still there. The hotel's a real place, and if you're ever in Seattle, it's well worth, you know, checking out.
We'll end on, and I heard you tell the story earlier, but the story, the title of the book, Bitter and Sweet.
The title of the book, Hotel on the Corner, Bitter and Sweet. It's a really long title. It was my first title, and I liked it, but my editor thought it was way too long. And so she asked me to write alternative titles, which, that's really weird. It's like asking you to kill your child, you know? So, and I, in a moment of passive resistance, I wrote 60 of the worst titles imaginable. You know, just like a noun and a verb, smash them together. What do you think? And they're just like, what? And in the meantime, the advanced copies went out, and people had read it, like librarians and bookstore owners, and they liked it, so we kept it. But I really think, you know, life, the book is equal measures bitter and sweet, and I think they're, it's cliche to say it, but you can't have one without the other. You know, they create a relativity, you know, that dynamic explodes between them. And there are moments, I was, in my life, where I've had both in such profound quantities that it was life-changing. The one that really came to mind was my mom died of lung cancer, and my brother and I took care of her in hospice care. And it was so frightening and sad and tragic and painful, but I wouldn't want to miss it for the world, you know? I was so happy to be there. And when you can meet fear with love, something good happens. And it was such a time of conflicted emotion. You know, my grandmother had always used this sort of really wonky Confucianism where she would talk about, you know, you should always eat, you know, bitter and sweet so you can understand, you eat them together so you understand that life is bitter and sweet. You know, only the kind of, you know, pseudo-Confucianism that an 80-year-old grandmother can get away with saying. But going through that with my mom, really, it was true. It was one of those moments that it was bitter, it was sweet, and one wouldn't have meant anything without the other.
Let's thank J.B. for it. Just went well, my dad. Couple things I would like to say. First of all, I would be remiss. Didn't the students do an amazing job? How about those transitions? And I also like to point you to your program that is listing on the back all of the wonderful events that we have, and they certainly are open to. Don't leave your seats just yet, because we have one really important thank you. One of the things that we would be remiss if we did not say is that this is the seventh year we've been doing this, and so we're looking very close at 10. And really, while this was a brainchild of three very wonderful academic and, you know, community-loving people, we would not have gotten this out of the off the ground without the incredible support of a board of trustees member and the head of the parents committee. And that person has had the vision and the belief in this program to support us all these 7 years. Patty and Daisy, thank you for all of you. I can't wait to see what we're going to do for that 10th year. So the programs are on the back. We are, in case you would like to have your book signed, we're going to give Jamie a couple seconds to actually stretch his legs, get a cup of water as he moves over to the table that's immediately on. Father Peter, I always get this confused. Is my right, you call that your left? I knew I would get it wrong. I try. It's over there. And we have some books for sale if you don't have one. If you did bring your book, Jamie has agreed to sign some. So we wish you good reading and good night.